So what do you do when you break up with a lover? It may involve alcohol, but I'll tell you one thing that I know I do. I find a tune that's sad and heartbroken, and I'll listen to it, and everything in it will seem to be about us. Right? So I'll go for a ride. I'll listen to tune after tune in my car. Might end up at home or someplace. And I'll hole up with myself and my feelings. Now, what do you do when you get a promotion or a raise? Or if it's just a wonderful, beautiful, sunny day? Again, I know what I do. I'll crank up a tune. I'll crank up a tune that captures the lift and the joy of that moment, that, you know, sort of crystallizes that feeling. Why do we use a tune? Why do we maybe even need a tune to go with our feelings? Well, I think about that a lot. Now, I think about it a lot because I've spent the bulk of my adult life writing music to go with things. And now, for the last 20 years, I've been teaching students how to do that. So, why do we do that? Why do we use music in this way? What does music do for us? Well, to think about that, I want to tell you a story. When my son Cal was very little, he was really into cars and trucks, or as he called them, gars and gucks. And when we'd be in the car, he'd be sitting in the back seat in his car seat, and he'd lean his head against the window, and as the cars and trucks went by, you'd hear him say, "Gaw, gaw, guck, gaw, gaw," right? And when we were at home, he would take anything, a block or a crayon, and he'd pretend that it was a car, right? And he'd run it around the surface of stuff. The thing is that if you leaned in close, you could hear something. He was singing. He was making sound, not the sound of the car, not vroom, vroom, vroom. He was going doo, 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 doo. He was singing. He was taking, using pitches, and you're putting them in rhythm. That's music. Now, why was he doing that? And what was that doing? Well, let's think about what he was doing when he was doing that. He was taking a crayon or a block, and he was imagining that it was a car, probably because he was into cars, right? So he would take this thing, and he'd hold this crayon, and he'd see a car. And he'd run it up and down the legs of the chair, and he'd see a road. So what he was doing was that he was taking something in his world and he was turning it into something that it was not. Another thing in another world. That's what imagining is. Imagining is being able to see through the crayon into the car that it can be. Now, that's a very amazing thing to do. He was just playing, and he was under two, but that's really quite a remarkable metaphysical feat. Now, I think that feat, having one thing stand for another thing, is the fundamental act of consciousness and of being human. And I think that it's the nature of things in our experience of them is that things can and do stand for other things. And that having that happen is an act of imagination, of creativity, and of play. And it's the thing that makes our world. So the thing is that when Cal did it, he heard music. That's right. The music of the car was just as important to the world of the car as the crayon was. So what was it about the car that needed music to help it be the car? Well, let's go back to that breakup. When I break up with someone, I feel a gigantic tsunami of feelings. Shock. Betrayal. Hurt. Loss. Regret. Relief. Self-doubt. Untetheredness. Now, I feel all of these things, and I feel them very strongly, but they might not be clear. In fact, it's pretty confusing. Let's take a look at something else. Now, we remember that day. When the Twin Towers fell, something important happened in our world. It changed intensely and deeply. Now, I want you to think about what it felt like when that happened. I wager that you felt pretty confused. I'll wager that it actually probably took you some time before you could get the feelings that you were having. So that's my point. My point is that feelings, that when we have something that's incredibly, when we are in an encounter a situation where we have, that's deeply emotional or that it's intense, or that when our world is changing, we feel a million things, but it may not be clear to us what we feel. What we need is help in feeling the things that we feel. And by that I mean feeling them in their specific and complete form. Now, I actually think that that's not unusual, that's actually the rule about feelings. And I think that rather than being immediately self-evident and obvious to us, I think our feelings are actually not. And that we can feel and think things and not know what they are. So our inner life is actually a mystery to us. So why do I have to hear a heartbroken or sad tune when I break up with my lover? Or better yet, why does every tune that I hear sound sad and heartbroken? It does because I need help. I need help to crystallize, to enunciate, to clarify, and to form my own feelings of sadness and heartbreak. And that the same thing is true about that promotion or that beautiful day. Those things don't get as promoted or as beautiful as they do when they get the music that they need. Now, there's a study I'm sure you've all heard of that's about the relationship between feelings of happiness and smiling. So the naive, obvious way of looking at it is that we smile because we're happy. But turns out that smiling makes you feel better. But actually, the opposite is the case, that when you smile, you feel happy. So smiling and feeling, you should try it, by the way, because it's true. Smiling and being happy are actually part of the same thing. Now, I think that's the way that feelings work. All feelings. Feelings are a feedback mechanism. We start to feel something, then we do something, and that something that we do reinforces our feeling, and then we feel a little more, etc., etc., etc. Now, the thing about it is that music is part of that system. That music, well, let me put it like this. I think that our feelings contain music in them. I actually can hear it. I think Cal can too. I think you can too. What music is, let me put it like this. Feelings need to speak to us, and music is a language they use to tell us what they are. Music is a language that we use to organize our emotional relationship to the world. And because emotions are a gigantic part of our world, music is part of our world-making process. So when we make a world, we need music. That's what Cal was doing. He was making the car be more car-y. That's what music does. Now, I work in film. And in film, what we do is that we tell a story by making a world. Now, the visual tool, now, by the way, when we tell that story, we are, the filmmakers are intensely interested in the feeling part of that story. It's a very important part of the telling of the story to tell the feeling of the story. And it turns out that the visual parts of the filmmaking tools are by themselves sometimes not sufficient to get across the feeling part of the story. Now, I see that all the time because I see movies with no music in them yet. Now, I want to show you a movie like that. I'm going to play a clip from a short film that I did. It's called Seduction Theory. And it's the story of a guy who is trying to overcome a difficult past and a difficult therapist father. It's told from a very interesting point of view, and the storytelling technique is kind of interesting because you're going to see a kid, a boy, but that boy is actually his adult self, and he's redoing his past. So let's take a look at this clip, the way I see it, without music.
Where have you been? I had some stuff to work out. How long have you been here? 20 years. I can't believe this is happening.
You know, this isn't gonna be like you imagined.
It's gonna be good, right?
right? Okay, now, that's how I see most of the stuff I see. Now, it's kind of a little slow, maybe. And maybe a little cold. And actually confusing. Okay, now let's look at it with the music that I wrote that we put in it.
Where have you been?
I had some stuff to work out. How long have you been here?
20 years.
I can't believe this is happening.
You know, this isn't gonna be like you imagined.
It's gonna be good, right?
Okay. So, when we see it with the music, at least for me, I hope for you, it's sort of more engaging, more alive, and it's sort of warmer and richer and full of meaning. So that's the task that music does in a film. It finds the inner meaning and poetry of the story, and it presents that so that the film can get imbued with the feeling that it needs. Now, you could say, oh yeah, well, the only thing we saw that was real, what was really there was the tree and the girl and the hill, right? And that's the real part. And I did something, I manipulated us. I manipulated our feelings with our music. But I don't think that's really what it is, because when you look at it as what I see, and I think that what you see, is that the film without the music is missing something. It's actually missing something. It's missing an important part of what's going on there. And it needs the music to make the reality of the film more complete, more full, and more powerful. Now, there are films that don't have any audio at all. Up until 1928, films had no soundtrack, and we call that time the silent era, and we call those films silent films. The thing about it is they were never silent. Silent films always had music with them. They were always performed with music. Seeing a film, a silent film, without music, everything is slow, cold, empty, confusing. It's not the way they're meant to be seen. Now, I've been thinking about this a lot. I spend a lot of time with silent films. Now I run the Berklee Silent Film Orchestra, and what we do is that we write new original scores for silent feature classics, and then we perform those scores live with a small student orchestra. So I want to take a look at a clip from a film that we just scored, and that film is a new restoration of a film called Varieté. Let's take a look at this clip. This is a clip sort of towards the end of the film. It's a very short clip. I want to see it with some music in it.
Thank you.
right? So in this clip, clearly that guy's drunk and he's leaving a bar, right? Wait, let's look at it with another piece of music in it. Let's see what happens with this piece of music. He's clearly very, very angry, and something bad is going to happen. It's the same movie, isn't it? No. The movie with different music is a different story. It's a different film. Now, scenes from films are not, they're usually, a film's a big, long thing. It's one of the big challenges of this talk is that there's really big, long things. But a scene is part of a movie. And in this movie, in the real movie, this is that guy is a trapeze artist. And he has left his family to run away with a young girl and be a trapeze guy. And what's just happened is that he's murdered his trapeze partner because that guy was having an affair with that girl. And he's going to turn himself into the police. Now let's take a look at that same scene with the actual music that we made. So clearly, when the film has that contact between the film and the music has great impact on the film. And when the film is right, I mean, when the music is right, the film becomes broader and deeper and more meaningful, more real. Same thing is true about the power of music in our own lives, in our everyday lives. Music has the power to affect us, to move us, to engage us, to enlighten us, even to define us. We live in a musical world, and we are musical creatures. All of us have the receptors and the muscles, the ears, and the hearts to feel music. Music helps reveal the world to us in all of its fullness. Music helps us to actually enunciate and to recognize our own feelings and our experiences, the stuff of the world. It's the very stuff of it. And music reveals ourselves to ourselves so that we can become more real to ourselves, so that we can become more real. Thank you very much.